Harry Dent, the author of Zero Hour, an economist who I think has called many things in the last 20 years, even longer than that, 30 years, really right on the money. Harry, welcome. How are you?
Oh, be back, Glenn.
So I want to talk to you a little bit about GameStop because, you know, I've been saying that the system has been gamed for a long time. I mean, when you know, George Bush had to violate the free market to save the free market, and we bailed all these banks out, et cetera, and then we just continue to do it. You and I talked about in what, 2019, you said in the spring something will happen and the stock market will fall and the economy will totally change. It was COVID that was that something that happened. And you've been right. Now, what does this mean, this GameStop thing? Some people say it's the beginning of the end and it's a real revolution. Some people say it was no big deal. Some people say that it is going to change and the oligarchs are going to rule because of this.
But, you know, I see it more on the revolution side because we're in a very important cycle like the American Revolution that brought in democracy and knocked down the monarchs for the first time. Before that, it was the Protestant Revolution that took down the all-powerful Catholic Church of the time. I think it's the central banks going down this time, and I cannot wait because this whole GameStop thing only happens in an environment I call the markets on crack. So people think the insiders are manipulating the market. A poll just showed 66% of people, insiders are manipulating the market. Well, it's worse than that. It starts with the Federal Reserve and central banks. They've been pumping money nonstop. Now, you got to remember, this is not lowering interest rates and inducing people to borrow a little more. This is literally putting trillions of dollars direct, created out of nowhere, into the markets, which means now more money chasing the same financial assets that pushes them up. But that's not all, because they say we're going to constantly buy these bonds, which pushes down long-term and short-term rates. That means bonds go up. Oh, and that means stocks go up. So the traders, the big traders, the real manipulators, see, oh my gosh, now we can leverage even more. And, oh, because we know the direction Fed's going to push stuff and we're not going to see downturns for long, it reduces the risk. Oh, and now it costs almost nothing with fake interest rates, zero rates, to finance this leverage. So what has been happening? I've been saying this for years, and you have too, Glenn. The big money, the hedge funds and the leverage traders, they throw their weight around. They have the best information. They know what everybody is doing. You, me, little traders, other funds, everything. And when they see people going in one direction, like bullish, they jump on it and they short. And the problem is, I don't mind that they short. Anybody should be able to go long or short. The problem is they can do it on high leverage with options and futures and literally just push a market down until the people that are long capitulate. So they've been doing this for a long time.
So, but,
and I saw the traders, it's hard to do.
Harry, what's really disturbing to me is, I mean, first of all, you're exactly right. The Fed has been they call it investing. They have been dumping money into the stock market, which creates a bogus stock market. They are putting money in, not little people. And what happens is when the Fed just starts to buy the stock market, the Fed has gone to advisors. Their advisors on who to invest in has been BlackRock. Well, now BlackRock, all of the heads of BlackRock, I think except for one, are now in the Biden administration. The chief economic advisor for the president, Biden, is now BlackRock executive. The chief economic advisor for Kamala Harris is now a BlackRock executive. The right-hand man for Yellen in the Treasury Department is a BlackRock guy. Even Goldman Sachs didn't have this.
The former Fed chairman, which puts a Fed chairman and a Fed person in the Treasury. So, yeah, we got everything locked towards endless stimulus, and this just invites leverage. So, again, Fed adds money to the markets, pushing up prices. Traders add a lot more leverage, pushing up prices anymore. You know what the most important number in the economy right now, Glenn? Nobody's talking about it. 500, $20 trillion in financial assets globally, 6.2 times global GDP at 84 million, and way more than money and everything else. This is the biggest bubble. It's worse than the debt bubble at 253 trillion. See, in a normal economy, a growth economy, debt might be 1.5 times GDP, and financial assets might be 2.5. Now there's 6.2, debts over 3 times. This is the greatest bubble, but the bubble now, because the central banks use quantitative easing, putting the money in, as you're saying, this is what's created the financial asset bubble. This is a bigger monster than the debt bubble, and that can deleverage and disappear money even faster than the debt deleveraging. So these guys are creating a monster that's going to kick them very hard, and I think it's coming literally in weeks or months. No more than that.
So I did a report back in 2006 or 7 when I was on CNN, and I did a monologue on the money bubble. I said, look, the housing bubble is coming, and it's going to burst, and it's going to be ugly. And then here's what's going to happen. And they've done all of those things. And I said at the end of that monologue, before the housing market bubble, I said the next bubble is going to be the money bubble or the everything bubble. Everything will be put in and grossly abused, and then everything comes down. Do you agree with that?
Yes. Yes. And that everything comes down by history. And I'm the guy that studies history and what actually happens instead of ideology. Okay. At least 40 to 50% of those financial assets will disappear forever. That is $200 to $250 trillion, 2.5 to 3 times global GDP is going to disappear. And if that's not going to cause a recession, Glenn, that's called a depression when you have that much deleveraging. And of course, then the debt deleverages. A lot of economic experts say, well, we kind of handled some of the debt stuff last time. That's not going to be as bad. No, no, the debt will deleverage. It's this bubble that's going to deleverage first and trigger the debt deleveraging, and the whole thing comes down. Glenn, I can see nothing other than something like 29 to 32 coming in the next 2 to 3 years, but that'll be it. You know, we've been in this slow
unless we go to the Great Reset. I mean, are you following what they're doing in Davos with the World Economic Forum?
I don't even follow those guys.
Oh, you got it. You have to. The Great Reset is happening here in America. It is.
Yeah.
It's incredible what they're doing, and I think they, you know, they're all just banding together for the Build Back Better campaign, which is not a Joe Biden campaign. That's the World Economic Forum, and all these prime ministers and world leaders are using it. And it is to, I think it's the biggest theft of wealth in all of human history.
But, you know, this bubble bursting, though, it's a good thing. In the 29 to 32 crash, it was horrible, but we eliminated about 40 to 50% of the private debt, which was off the charts back then. We got rid of a lot of zombie companies. You know, 19% of public companies, these aren't small businesses. Public companies, large public companies, can't even pay their debt service, and they keep limping along with this liquidity. GameStop goes up and down, you know, 482 points down to 112 in one day because there's so much liquidity that hedge funds can short it big time and knock it down. And then now small traders, which is a really great thing, have banded together and say, look, we're sick of you guys beating on us. They shoved those shorts up these guys, and they lost $5 billion. In a matter of days, Melvin Capital and some other hedge funds, because they did the same thing. When these guys were heavily short on high margin, they just bought on and pushed the stocks up to force them to cover their shorts and lose money and push the stock up.
So Harry, let me take you here, because I'm really torn on this, because I think that, look, I think you should be able to go long. I think you should be able to bet that a company is going to go down, go short, and you should be able to use your money. But that's not what they really do. They borrow. They have all kinds of devices that the average person doesn't have. And so when the Reddit people got on, they looked at that and said, they're 40% more than all of the shares. These guys are just pigs at the trough. Yeah. They're not even thinking. They're just money, 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 money. So I have no problem. Yeah. I have no problem with them figuring that out. But what I'm concerned about is a foreign country could come in and leverage the stock market and play these games. Should we have any kind of rules here for this, or just leave it alone and let the system be what it is?
Absolutely. Free market capitalism does not work without rules, but they need to be simple. Simple rule: you do not have margin and leveraged investing except to hedge. Commercial, all these options and futures and margin was so legitimate companies that need to deliver or purchase things in the future, investments or commodities, can hedge that and guarantee the price at a small cost, and they need margin and options and stuff to do that. It should not be used for what I'm calling what you just described, predatory investing. You see people leaning in one direction, and you just come down and dive bomb them until they capitulate and sell, and then you turn around and buy. That is not good for the markets. And again, hedge funds have been doing this big money forever. Now the small traders are doing the other end, and they're actually teaching the hedge funds, you better be careful next time you do this, because we're now watching you and doing the same thing. Now, but the problem is this creates this on both sides. You would eliminate all this stupid stuff if you didn't allow leveraged investing. Just you go short or long. Leverage is only for legitimate hedgers and not for predatory investing.
So, Harry, what does this mean, 29 to 33 kind of crash? You say coming in the next 45 days or so. And I've heard others say exactly the same thing. What does that mean for the average person, like the banks and your loans? Can they call them in? What does that mean? What's going to happen to the Homer Simpsons of the country?
Okay. First thing, it hits the rich the hardest. So that's the good news for everyday people. But everyday, what happens, these assets will go down, businesses will fail, loans will fail. Businesses will lay off workers and people will be foreclosed on. Real estate will go down 30 to 50%. Stocks will go down 60 to 90. So most people don't have a lot of assets.
Wait. You say stocks will go down 90%?
Yeah. 89% is what happened 29 to 32. That was just simply a long-term debt bubble deleveraging. It's the most powerful downturns. Glenn, this is what causes depressions instead of recessions. Recessions are cleaning out companies and ordinary debt. These are bursting major bubbles, and it's always ugly. So you have to get out of the way. The best thing, okay, real quick, get out of all leveraged assets, stocks, real estate that you can, and do not get out of a loan. Do not pay back a loan, because when loans fail this time, they're not going to be able to bail out the banks like last time. That didn't work. That's not going to be even possible. And you may get your mortgage written down 40 or 50% down to market this time. So get out.
Is what they should have done last time, called mark to market.
Mark to market, and they suspended that. See, that's why these things are good. These debts get written down at the expense of the banks. These financial bubbles go down at the expense of the rich and the traders and stuff. The everyday person may lose their job for several months or more and maybe have some foreclosures, but they end up coming out the winners when mortgages are more affordable again and they can invest for the future and stocks are more reasonable.
Why do you think they'll return to mark to market when they didn't do it the last time? And that was what they always did.
But okay, I said it earlier. They created a bigger, but to save the debt bubble from deleveraging and the banks with it, they started quantitative easing. It only worked with driving up assets, so they kept doubling down on that. This financial asset monster is bigger than the central bank. Remember what I said, 6.2 times GDP. When the next phase of this, you should notice, every stock crash since the peak in January, early to that 2018, which was the beginning of this crashing process, every crash has gone to lower lows after a higher high, and the next crash is due to be 45 to 50%, and that's when the central banks lose control. It goes down so much that people say, well, wait a minute, you keep pumping in money, you keep saving money, and we keep going lower, there's something wrong here, and they lose their credibility. I think central banks are going to go down like the Catholic Church and the monarchs did in the past two major.
I mean, in a way, I hope you're right about, you know, what they're going to do about it. I just don't think they're going to. I just think they're going to try to.
I don't think they're going to have a choice, Glenn. When you fail,
they're going to try to consult. They're going to try to. They're going to try to consolidate globally. They're going to make it bigger than it is now.
They can't do it. This is bigger than them. How can they control a $520 trillion monster? Where, as we observed in February, March of last year, stocks alone dropped 40% globally in 5 weeks. That was like $40 trillion hit to the global economy right there. Okay, then they pump again, but there's a point where you keep doing this and it keeps going lower every time. There is a point where it is seen as a failure and not a success. People still think the central banks are saving the economy. No, they're creating a twice as big a bubble as we had in 2007, and they will lose control. All bubbles go out of control because you can't keep doubling everything every several years and without it finally blowing, even without a trigger. And COVID is the perfect trigger because, Glenn, we have gotten back 80% V. The other 20% we don't get back. There's many industries, travel, entertainment, a lot of retail,
right,
that is not coming back for years. So we are not going to get back to normal, and yet the stock market's priced like we're going to have the greatest boom in history.
Harry, I looked at the January 6th. We had rioters in the Capitol. We had a consolidated government, all Democrats, that were talking about raising the taxes, you know, more regulation, and the stock market was going up while all of those things were happening. It made no sense.